rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 11 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I am humbled, honored, and blessed to bring you a bona fide big dog in the industry, Mr. Ted Rubin. Ted is an author, keynote speaker, CMO, brand evangelist, and social marketing strategist. Woo! How's them for credentials? He's also most popular for evangelizing the term RonR, which stands for Return on Relationship. He also released a book by the same name in January 29th, 2013. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Mr. Ted Rubin. I have the distinct honor of being joined by Mr. RonR himself, Mr. Ted Rubin. Ted, thanks so much for taking the time.
My pleasure, Temi.
Yeah, you did an interview with Brian Kramer a few months back about how to market to millennials. That's when I first started really following you in earnest. And I love the candor. I really did. I love the candor. You guys even looped in Brian Fanzo toward the end. And it was a really good conversation. So I'm really, really happy to have the opportunity to chat with you. So you are crazy on the speaking circuit. You've consulted for a lot of big names, but nobody starts at the top of the mountain. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
So, you know, if we're talking about bit by the bug of digital marketing, it was back in the 90s, you know, kind of a little bit, you know, a few years after it was all starting. It was 1997. I had closed a business that I had been very active in for most of the beginning of my career in the 80s. I got burnt out by the investment business. I took a little time off. I was helping build sales teams, working in a bunch of different areas, tried to start up my own business again, and, you know, came to the realization that a lot of your audience has probably learned that being successful once doesn't necessarily mean being successful right away again. Just because one business worked first time out of the gate doesn't mean the next one will first time out of the gate. You know, it's always a challenge. And I was looking for something new. I was not happy with what I was doing. I wanted to get back into something that I thought was going to be a booming area. And all of a sudden, I discovered digital. You know, I was working at a company, and, you know, we barely were using computers, like, just to update inventory. And one of the guys there was, you know, hey, man, you got to check this out. It's, you know, it's called the internet. And I got my first online computer in 1997, and I got online and started finding all these things and started staying up late at night. I had two young children, reading a lot of articles, and I read an article that was an interview of Seth Godin. And, you know, Seth, as most of us know him, is one of the most brilliant marketers in the world. At the time, it was before he was known in that way. He had already built a name for himself as a young entrepreneur. And I love what he had to say about how to market things digitally and what he was doing at this company called Yoyodyne that he had started, which was the first online direct marketing company. And at the end of it, the interviewer said to him, well, you know, Yoyodyne sounds like a really cool company and the culture sounds great. Do you have any job openings? And his answer was, I don't have any specific openings, but I'll always hire somebody smart. That's the way I build my company. And I kind of said, hey, I'm smart. And I was looking for something new, and I had been applying to a bunch of jobs online. And I wrote him a letter. Yes, a real letter with a resume attached saying, hey, you know, there's two things you mentioned in your interview. One, that you're selling something new that nobody knows how to sell, so there's nobody with quote-unquote experience, and you need people that can sell that kind of, this kind of thing. And number two is you want smart people. I said, well, I'm smart and I can sell anything. And at the time, my wife, who's been my ex-wife for many years, said, what are you, an idiot? Why are you applying somewhere where there are no job openings? And I'm like, well, the guy says he hires smart people. And she's like, well, you're not that smart. And I'm like, well, maybe I was, because I got a call 2 weeks later. And she calls me at the office. She says, oh my God, those people called. And that's what drew me into the business. I flew up to New York at the end of 1997. I met with Seth and his team, and we made a deal. And I moved back to New York, which I was anxious to do. And I jumped in with both feet. And I was very lucky. I was around a guy who ended up becoming one of the thought leaders then and now in the space, one of the leading guys. And I moved up. I made a critical error that I'll urge everybody in your audience to never do. When I moved up and left, I left my family in Florida, which I had to do, and I made the mistake of moving in with my in-laws. Don't ever, ever move in with your in-laws. I mean, especially if they're like the Costanzas from Seinfeld. All these people did was yell at each other, but I believe everything happens for a reason. I'm not an early riser, but it got me out of the house very, very early every morning. Because I didn't want to be there when they woke up and started screaming at each other. And, right. And the good fortune was that Seth was an early riser too, and we were the only two people in this cavernous office up in Irvington, New York. And every morning while he was eating his granola, he would start holding forth to me on all these ideas he had about how to market to people and how the world was changing. And while I was sitting there, he coined the term permission marketing, which now, let's see, that was almost 20 years later, is just a basic part of everything we do with marketing. People have to give you permission. You can't email them unless they want. Social media is the ultimate in permission marketing, because if I don't like what you're saying, I just unfollow you.
Right.
And Seth wrote this article for Fast Company, which then became his first best-selling book. And I was there, and I realized I was in the presence of greatness, and I just shut my mouth and listened. And I learned so much from him, and it was a big part of what I used to hear him talk about, and what we talked about those mornings was the beginning of my thinking on return on relationship, which became my first best-selling book and basically the hub for everything I do and talk about. So there's the story, maybe a little bit too long-winded, but how I got involved, and I've been involved in digital ever since. Went from there to a company called Bottle Rocket that was a game maker that got acquired by Activision and had an investment from Electronic Arts. Unfortunately, I was not a big part of that. I was not a big part of the shareholders. I was a big part of helping them be successful. Moved on to 800 Flowers, into the lead generation business, and more into the present time. I helped build a company called Elf Cosmetics, using basically social media. From there, went to the first peer-to-peer commerce business, which was OpenSky, and then on to Collective Bias, which created content at scale with user-generated content in a storytelling format to help shopper marketing. And here I am now talking about all this stuff. Collective Bias just got acquired by Inmar for in a nine-figure deal. So that's a great thing to have been a part of, and we'll probably be continuing my speaking, my consulting, my advisory work, and also getting involved in another startup with the founder of Collective Bias, John Andrews, a company called Prevailing Path, which will be the next stage of how consumers via content connect with brands and retailers.
I love it. I can definitely see that playing out as a made-for-TV movie. Like, that was epic. And you want to talk about being in the presence of greatness. My God, like, I can't even believe we're talking right now. And you said being lucky. I'm gonna mangle this quote, but like, luck is when hard work meets preparation or something to that effect. And that's what I really pulled out of your story. So thank you so much for sharing. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of, you know, shiny veneer come off and you're like, crap, stuff just got real?
Well, I just want to add one thing to what you just said, you know, and you gave a very valuable definition for luck. But I think one part that you left out that's really important is tenacity. Because luck, you've got to stick it out for luck to happen. I mean, right. You know, Winston Churchill said, when going through hell, keep going. And because if you don't keep going, there's nothing, you don't get saved, you're done. If you're in a business and you give up, it's over. Or if you're in a business and it fails, which happens plenty of times, if you don't start again, if you don't jump into whether it's a new career, a new business, a new job, then there's no chance for that to happen. So that's really important. It's back to your last question. You know, disenchantment, at least for me, and I think for almost everybody, comes and goes. I mean, you know, we get a great job, we love it, it's going great, everything can be perfect, but we can run into a boss that puts roadblocks in our way. We can be involved in a business that doesn't have enough financing to continue going, even though you've been doing everything right. You can end up losing your job or having a family emergency or catastrophe that takes you away. And I think all of this leads to disenchantment, whether it's at the moment, whether it's with the business, whether it's with our family. Again, back to the whole you know, no let up tenacity thing. You got to keep putting one foot in front of the other and figuring out a way to make it better. I've had a lot of success in my career and I've had a lot of failure. And the only reason I've had a lot of success is because after I failed, I picked myself up and I figured out how to do something again, even if it meant starting at the beginning. Before I went into digital, I had a very successful investment business. There was a bad investment climate in the end of the 80s for small investment firms. I lost my business. I had a significant amount of money saved up. I blew through it, starting a couple of businesses that didn't work and taking some time off. And then I ended up starting at the beginning with a company, taking a job well below like what you would think I was capable of, because I had a wife and I had two children and I needed it. And I hear guys all the time, you know, say to me, well, I'm not doing that, or that's bullshit, or, hey, man, go in and make it better. I think really looking back, one of the talents that I consider my own is taking a shit job and turning it into something better. Taking a role that isn't what you wanted it to be and turning it into something that helped make you successful again. Right. And to me, that's being resourceful, that's being tenacious, and that's what no let up is all about. You know. And again, this can happen because of failure. This can happen because of bad decisions. This can be happen because of a bad economy. This can happen because someone in your family gets sick or a friend does and you have to be there for them. And you have to pay less attention to the business side than the personal side. And all of those things cause a lot of us to have to get on the comeback trail. And it's, you know, look, I'm 59, and one of my things I say is I don't want to have to come back again. I'm riding a wave right now. I'm like the guy on the surfboard, and this one's got to take me into shore. So, you know, I've been fortunate that, again, Collective Bias was acquired. That's something I worked long and hard on for a bunch of years when I was there. I built their brand. John Andrews, their co-founder, will tell you that. It's in my bio. A quote that he gave when I left. And fortunately, the people that continued after that did an amazing job of building and growing the company and eventually selling it. So, you know, that's a great thing. And now I'm looking at things, you know, you come to different points of your life and you look at things in different ways. So I'm looking to get involved in some more. But again, it's all about starting again and driving forward.
Sage advice, very sage advice. So you're a man of a certain age. If you could go back and you had a time machine, you know, and you can go back in time and talk to your younger self without, you know, causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yeah, I watched Doctor Who, you know, sue me. What are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Oh, boy. You know, that's really hard to boil down because, you know, when you get to this point of your life, there's so many things. I guess what I would say is stick with things longer. You know, as much as I preach, you know, look, I haven't given up. I've come back, but I feel sometimes I'd have to come back from farther back than I would have if I hadn't stopped trying with something I was in, if I hadn't given up thinking the easier route was either to shut this business down. And, you know, look, it's easy to have 20/20 hindsight. Mm-hmm. At the time, you know, I obviously I felt I was making the right decisions, but you're asking me now, of course, to look back with the value of that 20/20 hindsight. And what I would tell my younger self is do everything you can to complete what you started and continue learning, whether it's a new skill you're taking on. Don't get to that point where you say, hey, you know, I've got enough of this skill, I'm going to move on to the next one. Keep learning in that skill, keep adding to it. I wish I was a better skier. I wish I had started taking martial arts at a younger age. I wish I continued working out harder during the way. You know, I mean, there's businesses I wish I didn't walk away from when I did. Again, I have the value of 20/20 hindsight now, and so even though I'm saying this, I'm not sure even hearing this as my younger self that I would still make those better decisions, because, you know, it's very easy when we get older to say things that we should have done different. It's very hard to affect them while we're there and living it.
And there you have it, folks. It don't get much better than that. So we're going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deep with Mr. Ted Rubin. Stay with me. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry. This is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing, for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. And we're back, Ted. So you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss are all chilling at the bar after a conference, having a straight talk mini mastermind, or insert, you know, whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Understanding the value of relationships. I think too many businesses today still think that they can hide behind their digital media, their advertising, their public veneer, their quote-unquote mission statement, instead of actually empowering their employees to live it. Now, there are companies that do. A couple of great examples that I talk about often are Ritz-Carlton, which is all about the customer. They are all about the customer. They do everything they can to make that customer experience something special. And they don't look and measure everything from minute to minute when it comes to ROI. Ritz-Carlton takes hours and hours and hours in recruitment, in training. There's no way they can measure that directly to ROI. But what they can do is look over the course of time and see how it enhances their reputation, how their employees are thought of as the best in the business, how they're recruited by other companies. And they realize what it's done to build their brand and to the longevity of their company and their profitability. JetBlue is another company that invests a lot of time and effort in relating to their customer, even in a very, very difficult business like the airline business, where there are very few people saying thank you. I mean, the majority of people are complaining. So I think that companies have to stop worrying about a direct line to return on investment. But please don't misunderstand me. Return on investment is very important, and you have to look at it. But looking at it from minute to minute instead of over the course of time or over the course of a quarter or a year is way more important than looking at it day to day. I spent this money on media. This is what it produced. I picked up the – well, we so many CEOs or CMOs are now saying, you know, well, you know, so we have those conversations. We don't really know the value of them. I think that in today's day and age where sharing has become so incredibly easy and the sharing our experiences happens minute to minute and day to day, companies have to start recognizing the value and how that's a part of answering people, the customer experience, how people feel about your brand, how they feel about the employees in your brand, and how human they feel you're actually being. And the only way to do that is to empower your employees to act like people and to treat them that way, and that everything isn't boilerplate, and you give them the ability to think. Let them make mistakes. They'll learn from them.
Shit, I can dig that. Definitely dig that. So without getting political, but by all means express yourself. I mean, your candor is one of the things I like about you. What's your take on the whole fake news backlash and subsequent crackdown that happened on Facebook? Because at first, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off. He was like, oh, it's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome. Then they came out and said they're going to roll out some sort of, you know, verification process, but they don't want to become the arbiters of truth, per se. And I'm honest, I'm still forming my opinion, because on the one hand, I could go straight First Amendment, like, okay, they're a platform, and as a platform, it's not really their place to try to, you know, mediate that. But on the other hand, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, be it terrestrial or digital, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. I mean, let's say you have a pool in the back. I don't know if you do or not. And you're away on business and some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence to go skinny dipping and one of them drowns. Right? Like, it happened on your property. So you are ultimately responsible for that. So where do you stand on the whole fake news slash verification issue?
You know, I'm not sure where I stand. I think that there's two different sides to this. One of it is fake news that is being passed off as real news by media businesses, whether they be micromedia businesses like a blog or others. And then you or I writing, I think that this conspiracy is happening, or I believe, you know, that there were lots of illegal aliens voting in the election. To me, that's something Facebook can't moderate. But I definitely think that there's a place for looking at some of the news that is being passed off as being Fox or being CNN. I mean, that for sure. There's all these sites that lead you to believe. Let's forget about the bloggers who try to hold themselves up as real journalists who are doing research. That's a little bit harder. That's probably the middle part of ground of this thing. But there's a lot of these sites that lead you to believe you're on Fox, you're on CNN, you're on NBC. I think those definitely have to be – they have to do everything they can. Now, I'm not a techie. It's totally out of my wheelhouse, so I don't know what it takes to do that. I don't know if there's an algorithm, or it takes an algorithm probably combined with a huge amount of human interaction and judgment. But I think that it does behoove them to remove a lot of that stuff. Just like if I use somebody's song on a video and it's copyrighted and I haven't paid for it. You know, and it gets taken down, right? Have you ever tried that? You made a video, mm-hmm. You added a song to it, you put it up on Facebook, and immediately they take it down saying, you know, you don't have the copyright to this music. Right. Now, by the way, I think there's a huge missed business opportunity there. We can get into that after this. But back to the fake news. I think when they know there's misdirection or something like that, I think it is a responsibility of them to figure out a way to economically and take that stuff down and clear it out. As far as, you know, the Breitbarts of the world, that's a little tougher because they are, and please, I use this word very freely, Breitbart is quote unquote a legitimate media business. I say that mainly because of their size and the fact that they're well financed, not that I think that they're real journalists. But they're not putting something up and implying it's being said by a legitimate or other news organization. They're making it pretty clear that it's coming from them. And then it's your job as an individual to decide, do I believe that? Hey man, you watch Fox and CNN, and a lot of people have difficulty differentiating from commentators and journalists. There are journalists on CNN and Fox that are reporting the news. You can pretty much trust what they're saying. They're reporting it as a news story. Then there are commentators who are giving you their opinion. You, on both of those, whether it's the liberal or the conservative side, you have to recognize that those people are speaking from opinion. Now, there are the better commentators who make it very clear they're sharing their opinion. And then there are the less legitimate commentators who make it sound like what they're reporting is news when in actuality it's commentary. So again, I think that stuff's okay. I think it's okay when you and I share our opinions, and Facebook should not be moderating that. But again, when there are sites that are passing themselves off as legitimate journalistic media companies, I think that they have a place to be taking a look at that. But look, like you said right in the beginning, it's a very fine line between freedom of speech and these, again, being platforms where they're just allowing others to post. So I think this is a sticky wicket, as they would say, across the pond.
I dig it. And you brought out a very important distinction, the difference between a commentator and a journalist. And I think that's something that people, not enough people, are able to differentiate and need to take into consideration. So that's what's up. One last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time. This is a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his podcast, but I'm steering it in a very deliberate direction. So I am going to take just a few minutes to set that up. Plus, every podcast is somebody's first podcast, so I don't want to assume that anybody listening to this knows my position. So in my personal opinion, it's also my professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a brand or a corporation or works at an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 or a 1099 at the end of the year. And so, using my own story as an analog, you start off meandering the wilds of Google for a year or 10, and there is some good information out there, but it does take some rooting out, and there's no guarantees there, right? You might land on a lynda.com, you might end up doing Amway, like who knows, right? And after you're done taking your chances on Google, at some point you get serious and you decide to jump. And at that point, there's sort of two career paths in terms of education and career trajectory. You could do what I did, which is to go back to school to get a degree specific to internet marketing. The problem with that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my undergraduate. Plus, it's time consuming. Even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And 30 months in the digital space is a couple different lifetimes. Like, a lot can change in between then. And I'm a distinct minority that I took that path. By far the more prevalent way that the industry educates itself and disseminates best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less than going back to school for a degree, you got to have that money up front. So take some of the better conferences like a South by Southwest, MozCon, or Marketing Pros B2B Forum. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, food for however many days. Once you add all that stuff back in, you're looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And again, you gotta have that money up front. So what I'm trying to do, in essence, to go back to the whole time machine question I asked you a while back, is I'm trying to crowdsource a way in terms of professionalizing yourself and career path that doesn't include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or coming up with a bunch of money up front for these expensive conferences. So now that I've just rambled on for however many minutes, I'll get to the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skills, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, baby. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Well, 30 days is a really short time span. I don't think you can really accomplish a lot in 30 days. I mean, you certainly can accomplish something, but I would say, and I would say this as an answer to any of your people throughout that whole story you gave, whether you're going to college, whether you're going to seminars, you know, and conferences, whether you're a college freshman broke and sitting in your room, start building an online presence. Build your personal brand. Number one, start a blog. Get something that you own. You don't own Facebook. You don't own LinkedIn. You don't own Instagram. You don't own Snapchat. Tomorrow, they could change their terms of service and you could lose everything you have there. So, first of all, own tedrubin.com. I own my daughter's names in .coms, even though neither of them have any interest in it right now. And as it changes and evolves, I'll buy them whatever's next that becomes their own. I would make that the base of everything, and I would start writing blogs. Now, if you're a college student or you were a college student, you're either creating content or you have created content at scale to get through your education. Start using that content and publishing it. It's probably been graded. It's probably being corrected. I publish. It doesn't get corrected until someone calls me out after I publish it. So I would start doing that, and then I would open up accounts at LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Instagram. Again, I'm talking about an unemployed person with only time on their hands and no money, right? Mm-hmm. So there's no excuses. There's no excuses. I don't have time. By the way, if you're a mom and you have a job or a dad and a job and everything else, then I would say pick something that's the most valuable. Probably go with Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn. But if you're not, go to everything. Start publishing. Start writing your thoughts. Start following people. If you don't have anything to say, Start sharing content from people you want to get to know. If I want to get to know Temi and I don't know him from a hole in the wall, what am I going to do? Every blog post he posts, I'm going to comment on. I'm going to share it. I'm going to write things. I'm going to let him know how much I think of it, because eventually Temi's going to go, who the hell is this guy? You know, wow, he's sharing all my content. He's writing valuable comments on each of them. I would have a number of very basic comments pre-written so I could be posting them on different people's blogs, because the best way to get attention is to post on the blogs of people with very large followings and very large readership. There's a reason Seth Godin does not allow comments on his blog. He'll tell you it's because, and partially it is, it's his house and he doesn't care about your opinion in his house. Okay? But the truth of the matter is he doesn't want you building your brand on his back. Because if he publishes and has a million views a week and you're the first guy to comment every day, guess who's seeing Temi's comments every day? A million plus people. So there are a lot of blogs out there that still let you comment on their blogs. So I'd be commenting on blogs. I'd be sharing those posts. Here's one of the tricks I do. I comment on a blog. I cut and paste my comments. I post the comment to the blog, then I take the blog, post it to my social channels, and I add my commentary above it, what I wrote in the comments. So, Temi, I love what you wrote. Your perspective on looking for a job is tremendous. Here's a little tip I would give you, and that might be the comment I left. I would take that same comment, make it the lead into the post on Facebook, on LinkedIn, on Google+, so that now I start, not only am I sharing content of somebody valuable who other people want to read. Oh, wow, it's Seth Godin's post. I want to read that. But my commentary is right above it. So there's a couple of tips for you. If you want me to keep going, I could keep going. Syndicate. Everything you write, share everywhere. If you write a blog post, share it on Facebook. Share it on LinkedIn. Share it on Google+. Then I take the same blog post and I share it and I publish it via Medium. So I take my one blog post. So here's what happens with me. I get paid by SAP to write for them. I write a blog post that gets posted on SAP Hybris Future of Commerce blog. 2 weeks later, I take the same blog post and I post it to tedrubin.com. 2 weeks later, I post the same post to the socialcmo.com. Then I post it on LinkedIn. Then I post it on Medium as a published post, not as a link. Then I publish it on HuffPo. And every time I do that, I syndicate it. So when it gets posted on SAP, I take the link, you know, the way you do with a post, I put it on Facebook, LinkedIn, Google+. When I do it at tedrubin.com, I put it on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Google+. I do this over a 2-month period. I've now gotten a huge amount of content and life out of one blog post. Then I take the blog post and I break it down into paragraphs. And I publish just one paragraph on Facebook with nothing else. No link to the post, just a shorter piece of content for people to absorb and comment about. Then I turn the whole blog post into tweets. And I tweet that out regularly. And I have a whole thing of tweets. And I'm constantly, I put out new content. But I also go back and share all my old content again and again and again, as long as it's relevant. Don't live under the illusion that people have created that you have to create all new content. It's the content creators and the agencies that have created that myth, because they want you to pay them to keep creating content. But you can use the same content over and over again. There you go.
I love it. I hope y'all was taking notes, because y'all just got a master's class. That was phenomenal. Ted, please take a moment. Tell people how to get a hold of you, your social media profiles, any projects you got going on. How can we get some more of you?
Well, I'm real easy. I'm Ted Rubin everywhere. Ted Rubin on Twitter, Ted Rubin on Facebook, on Instagram, Ted Rubin USA on YouTube, Ted Rubin on Snapchat. You go there, you'll find it. Google Ted Rubin. About the first 10 pages will be me. I also have a history of fighting to keep my children in my life, so I have this whole thing called This Dad Won't Quit. I have a Twitter handle, This Dad Won't Quit. I got a video about it that you can find on YouTube. No Let Up is a big part of what I preach, that it's return on relationship, but there's no let up in life. You just got to keep going. My phone number is 516-270-5511. My email address is tedrubin@gmail.com. Reach out anytime. And as far as new things I'm working on, I've got a new book coming out called The Age of Influence. I'm working on a book with my business partner, John Andrews, called Retail Relevancy, which will be a big part of the company we're launching in Q1 of 2017 called Prevailing Path, which is basically the path to purchase for consumers in today's retail environment.
Prevailing Path. I look forward to it. Ted, thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure, Temi. Thank you for reaching out. It's been a pleasure. And you make it a great week, man.
You too. Thanks. Have you ever been paralyzed while doing research? You go to Google, you type in your search query, and seconds later, you're hit with millions, if not billions, of search results, and you can't make heads or tails out of any of them. Overwhelmed and afraid you'll make the wrong choice, you don't make any choice at all. Well, friends, you're not alone, but you needn't suffer in silence. The ability to make sense out of what you find online, and more importantly, call BS when you see it, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as what I've learned getting a degree in internet marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. One more time, bit.ly.com/DMD course. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe to iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.